More than 50 years ago, American and United Nations soldiers fought a bitter and bloody war in a country most Americans had never heard of. Many weren't quite sure what we were fighting for. I'm Walter Cronkite. In just 3 years in Korea, 37,000 Americans lost their lives on the battlefield. Thousands more are still listed as missing. Korea has often been called the Forgotten War, but never by the men and women who risked their lives in battle. These are their stories.
Major funding for this program was provided by the Disabled American Veterans National Service Foundation, working to build better lives for America's disabled veterans and their families. And by Ford Motor Company, proud to salute America's Korean War veterans. Additional funding provided by Bowater Incorporated, forever grateful for our veterans. By the PNC Financial Services Group, in thanks to those who serve our country. And by contributions to your PBS station, from viewers like you. Thank you.
This is Jim Israel.
They couldn't have picked a better name for the Korean War than the Forgotten War.
Where Jimmy liked to play.
We were fighting a force that was attempting to overthrow the world.
This is Jimmy's grass, where Jimmy liked to lay around.
It was a very nasty, dirty, brutal war for the brave Americans who had to fight it.
Well, I was down in the Keys and I was fishing. And somebody come up and said, you got a telegram, you should look at it. And it was a notice that I had been recalled back to the Marine Corps. And I wasn't altogether pleased and happy about it because I was having a good time. And I've got to say, awfully worried about what was happening in the world.
No one was more surprised by a war in Korea than the generation of young Americans suddenly asked to fight for another country's freedom.
What were we saving? South Korea? From whom? North Koreans? The concept wasn't even there. What had the United Nations got to do with us? All we knew is that we had taken an oath and we assumed a responsibility. And we had a job to do, and the flag was flying, and that flag should never touch the ground.
In those days, if your country was engaged in a fight or a war with another country, you just automatically assumed that your country was right. And you also automatically assumed that the proper thing for you to do was to do your share and get in there and do what you could to win the war.
I was in the 24th Infantry Regiment, 25th Division, which is an all-black regiment. They sent me because I was a veteran of World War II.
I got into the war because they needed nurses very badly, and I just thought it was my duty to join and try to help out.
I was so gung-ho. They call me Sergeant Combat, and I wanted to be in combat to prove myself to these guys that I was as good as they were.
Unfortunately, I was one of the young men who would not go to school. So we doctored my baptismal certificate to put me up a couple years, and I got into the Army in April of 1950. But I certainly wish I would have stayed in high school.
The late 40s and in 1950, the first new cars appeared. And what excitement for a family to get a new car. The first housing was really going up. So you could finally move out of the fourth floor of the house with mom and dad with your bride and get your own little place.
World War II had ended just 5 years before. People were starry-eyed about the future. No one expected another war so soon.
You know, I think we have to go back a little bit historically and remind people of what it was like back then. Coming out of World War II, I don't think anyone had foreseen that communism was going to make such an all-out attempt to spread itself all over the world. And we saw this as a threat, and there was no guarantee that the free world was going to remain free.
Following World War II, the United States and the Soviet Union partitioned Korea along the 38th parallel. Two rival governments were formed, the Democratic Republic of Korea in the south and the Communist People's Democratic Republic of Korea in the north.
The Russians never really fully accepted the division of Korea. It was their clear intention, it became obvious in retrospect, to unify that country under communist control.
The war started because Stalin had a scheme to expand communist power in Asia. North Korea thought that America would not react. So they attacked with Soviet-made tanks, Yak fighter planes, and all heavy equipment provided by Moscow. Within 3 days, Seoul was taken by the Reds. Within 3 days.
We were very fearful that the conflict could spread beyond the Korean Peninsula.
On June 27, 1950, President Harry S. Truman committed American troops to help stop the invasion.
Harry Truman called it a police action so that he wouldn't have to go to Congress for a declaration of war.
The same day, the United Nations also voted to send troops to support Democratic South Korea. The Soviets did not attend the session. Suddenly, the world was at war again.
We could have hardly gone into a war more poorly prepared than we did when we jumped so suddenly into the Korean War back in June of 1950.
U.S. occupation forces in Japan, under the command of General Douglas MacArthur, were rushed to the Korean Peninsula.
The first United Nations troops were hopelessly outnumbered and outarmed. Their mission was to delay the enemy's advance in a desperate fight for time.
Lieutenant Colonel Charles Brad Smith of the 24th Division, his battalion was the first troops that made contact with the North Koreans as they were pouring down south of Seoul.
Initially, the South Korean army, as near as I have been able to gather, were terrified of the tanks to the extent that if tanks were in the vicinity, it was time to move out. General Church led me over to a map and he said, all we need is somebody up here who won't run when they see tanks. About maybe 7:30, I could see something moving coming out of Suwon, 6 miles away. Very quickly, I determined it was a tank, and then another tank. And finally, it was 33 tanks coming our way. And we were 375 infantrymen. It turns out that we were being attacked by two regiments of the North Korean 4th Division, each regiment with a strength of 3,000.
He had no anti-tank weapons except little 2.36 rocket launchers. He started firing these pathetically like pea shooters at the enemy tanks, but the tanks just rolled right on through him.
I called my company commanders together and told them that if we were going to live to fight another day, we had better get out of here now.
Hey, when American troops first hit Korea, we thought, you know, the North Koreans had run the minute they saw an American. They didn't run. They beat the hell out of us. And we had to keep retreating down the peninsula until we could find a position that could be defended with fewer troops than what was attacking us. The soldiers at the front lines and the leaders began to realize we are up against a sophisticated enemy, and we have got us a full-size, sure enough, war on our hands.
As U.S. troops retreated south, they were joined by tens of thousands of desperate Korean refugees trying to escape the communists. Sometimes hidden among them were North Korean snipers. When fighting broke out, civilians were caught in the deadly crossfire.
Now, you put young people in the field in a highly fluid situation, as it was in Korea. Most of them are not well trained. You have a very well trained enemy coming at them. You're going to have lots of panic occur. And I'm sure that there were a great number of innocents that were killed.
By July of 1950, UN forces were trapped in a 90 by 50 mile pocket around the southern port of Busan. They were battling to hang on.
Well, the Busan perimeter was the place where the high command was able to finally stop, along the Naktong River mostly, which provided a natural defensive line.
The Busan perimeter was it. We had to hold it or it would have been America's Dunkirk.
By the time we got there in early August, the North Koreans had driven the 24th and the 25th almost into the waters. And as we proceeded, when we did land in the north, we were greeted by trucks of dead GIs just stacked up like fireplace wood, with tarpaulin over them.
To rescue the troops at Busan, General MacArthur, now head of the UN command, pressed ahead with a risky plan to land troops behind enemy lines at the port of Incheon on Korea's west coast.
The MacArthur tactic was a brilliant military maneuver. Many military officers advised against it, and he went ahead with it.
Our purpose of going into Incheon was to relieve the pressure on the troops encircled at Busan to the south.
What the Incheon operation did was throw the North Koreans into a panic, because now their rear areas and their ability to get out had been cut off. They were, in effect, out on a limb.
On 16 September, the 1st Marine Division moves through Incheon. Their objective is Seoul.
It was successful, but as we going into Seoul, that was a very difficult fight there. Again, it was street fighting from house to house, building to building, and we had to go through and use tanks and sometimes blow the buildings apart. And we lost a lot of good Marines there at that time.
I went into Seoul shortly after that. I can remember walking in single file with a company of American soldiers, seeing on all sides of us wreckage and human misery. And the one sight that will remain with me forever and is burned in my mind as if I was looking at it now was of a little Korean child sitting on the curb, weeping bitterly. And one of the soldiers in this file turned to his fellow soldier and said, "What's the kid crying about?" And the other soldier responded, "He's just learned that he's a Korean."
Following the Incheon landing and the recapture of Seoul, General MacArthur ordered American and UN soldiers to move rapidly north across the 38th parallel. The goal was to destroy what remained of the North Korean army and reunify the country. But the Chinese had other plans.
One of the great mistakes that General MacArthur made was his failure to recognize that the Chinese had entered the war. Touring around the area on reconnaissance in my Jeep, every village, every person we met was talking about Chinese, Chinese, Chinese. There were Chinese everywhere.
Soon the bitter North Korean winter began to set in. The temperature could drop to 40 degrees below zero, and the troops were not prepared.
I remember on trips up to the front lines that the Marines had the old Mickey Mouse thermal boot, which was an innovation in those days. The Army was still with the old World War II leather boot, so at night the Army would sneak across the division lines and try and swipe the boots from the Marines.
On November the 3rd of 1950, when we were on the Yalu River in North Korea, we were under an impression that the war was over, and we were waiting to go home. We had no winter clothing at all because we didn't think we would need it.
MacArthur said to his army in November, "We've won the war. The communists are finished," and left his army out exposed. And then he made the announcement, "We'll be home for Christmas."
Well, in Thanksgiving of 1950, we were located in the Chongchong Valley on the Chongchong River, about 15, 20 miles north of a little town of Kunuri. And the mess sergeants brought up our Thanksgiving dinner, turkey and the trimmings in the hot food containers.
And there was nothing happening. It was very quiet. It wasn't even a shot fired. And then all of a sudden, a tremendous bugle blowing, horns blowing, and the Chinese crossed the border.
Just before daylight, when the first rosy fingers of dawn were streaking through the eastern horizon, firing began to break out, and we found out that there were Chinese soldiers all around us and among us. They were swarming all over us. And for the next hour until it got daylight, we were engaged in a bitter firefight, hand-to-hand fighting. We had to leave our people behind, who were begging us not to do so. They were wounded in the rice paddies alongside and screaming, "Please don't leave us behind. Don't go off and leave us." But we had no choice.
I'm very happy that I got out. However, a lot of my colleagues did not get out. There was only 10 of us that got out of 250 that was either killed or captured.
And no one even talks about why we allowed all of those men to be surrounded and chopped up like they were. And even today, they don't even talk about it. But it was wrong.
The problems were just beginning. Across the mountains near the frozen Chosin Reservoir, 25,000 men in the U.S. 1st Marine Division were surrounded by Chinese and fighting for their lives.
And about 10:30 at night, flares started flying. Chinese screaming, "Marine, you die, Marine, you die." And they came forward and saw wave-like tactics. I got hit in the face and chest by fragments of grenades. People saying, "Captain, what do we do?" I said, "You better fight or we're not ever gonna get out of here."
It was the first wave would have hand grenades. The second wave would have rifles. The third wave would have nothing. As the Chinese troops in front would fall, the ones behind would pick up their rifles and continue in.
There was a Tokan Pass that had to be held. If they had taken the hill, they could have cut off the only road and our men wouldn't have gotten out. I was able to get behind a rock and shield myself, and I was able to pick some of them off. I got hit in the leg on the right side, trying to get the ammo cans to the machine gun that was on the point. And then I got hit the second time in my lower part of my left leg. It's like Custer with the Indians surrounded him.
And the regimental commander sent to me and told me in somewhat desperate terms that we've got to rescue them. It would have been disastrous for that entire part of the operation if we had failed to open that pass.
After the third day, Colonel Ray Davis broke through to help us hold the hill.
By this time, the 200-man plus company was down about 20% on their feet. The place was just strewn with frozen Chinese bodies everywhere.
Here are some of the casualties, which among Americans alone have passed the 40,000 mark, with 6,700 dead and 27,000 wounded. Another 6,100 are missing in action.
And when they carried me off the hill, the doctor had came in to me and said, I got some good news for you. And I figured, what in the hell can good news be after I just had my two legs amputated? And he said that the division broke out. And it just turned me completely around from feeling sorry for myself to being happy.
When you're standing there in combat or laying down in a foxhole and your foxhole buddy raises his head and gets hit in the head and half of it blown off, you really then realize that just how short our lifespan is and just how fragile we as human beings are.
When you look back on it, the jet aircraft came of age in the Korean War. Fortunately, the Air Force had F-86s. That was the only airplane that could really go head-to-head with MiGs.
In one aspect of the war, the air campaign, U.S. and U.N. forces were dominant. Marine pilots and naval aviators flew dangerous ground support missions to help those on the ground battle overwhelming forces.
Most of my original missions were on close air support work in front of the troops or going up country beyond the lines and hitting bridges and roads and communications centers and things and troop concentrations, things like that.
Oh, it was muddy and it was lousy looking weather. And all I could keep saying, God, why the hell am I here? But the experience that I had in Korea, I wouldn't trade ever. I met the greatest bunch of men that I have ever met in my life. And one was John Glenn.
Probably half the missions that Ted flew in Korea, he flew as my wingman. And he was very, very good.
I made a little bit of a boo-boo that could have been, oh boy, could it have been bad.
Ted got hit and had fire coming out from around the engine, and usually blew the tail off, the whole thing would blow.
But in this particular case, there was no fire in the cockpit, and I dreaded to think I was gonna have to bail out of a plane, and I really probably should have bailed out. But anyway, belly landed, got on the mat. No wheels, but boy, I was screeching to a stop.
That was a very close call. That's about as close as you can come and still make it.
I didn't get hurt, but it was pretty hairy, I'll tell you that.
Further north, near the Chinese border, in a zone called MiG Alley, U.S. Air Force pilots waged intense air-to-air combat with North Korean, Chinese, and Soviet pilots.
The Russians trained and ran the war and had actually over 900 aircraft involved in that war. It was not uncommon to see 1,000 MiGs in the air at one time. And the Chinese and North Koreans were notoriously bad pilots and no match for us. But the Russians would give you a good fight and many times beat you.
The North Korean and the Chinese forces were all being launched from bases north of the Yalu River. The MiGs would come down and attempt to get at our fighter bombers, and we would counter those with our patrols along the Yalu River of F-86s to prevent them from coming south.
The guns we had deployed on the F-86 there were 50 calibers. It was not sufficiently powerful to shoot an airplane down unless you got really close and hosed the guy.
We're about 5,000 feet. There is flak going off around, and all of a sudden, a high-tailed MiG-15 slid in front of me, and then we started scissoring back and forth, both of us trying to get behind the other. Eventually, I was able to get behind him and fire some shots, hoping that pretty soon this engagement would be over. I got enough hits, evidently, so he sort of leveled out and headed toward a ridge of a mountain. I thought he might crash, but then he eased up and then ejected. From a fighter pilot's perspective, your profession is to be involved in combat, and there's a sense of wanting that to be able to continue. It's exciting, it's aggressive, and you feel a little sad that it's over.
It's funny, you know, even today, aviators and pilots don't think they're shooting at another guy, they're shooting at another airplane. And interesting, isn't it?
In January 1951, the Chinese began a major new offensive to drive UN forces off the Korean Peninsula.
And they were marching in a column of four abreast and at least regimental size, if not more. We had on the road two sets of quad 50s. These 50 caliber rounds were smashing into this column of fours at a horrendous rate of casualty, and they just kept marching. Our soldiers got so traumatized by the killing that many of them stopped firing.
The unexpected entry of 300,000 Red Chinese across the Manchurian border may well precipitate World War III.
If aggression is successful in Korea, we can expect it to spread throughout Asia and Europe and to this hemisphere.
The president has stated that the use of the atomic bomb is being considered to halt the communist onrush inspired by Russia.
I think that it's quite true that the Korean War was a dangerous war in the sense that it might have led to nuclear exchanges. It conceivably could have because it took place at the very height of Cold War tensions.
Within 3 days, the communists had recaptured the South Korean capital of Seoul. The situation was becoming desperate.
Our army commander, Walton Walker, was killed in Seoul, and they flew in a new guy. His name was Matthew Ridgway, and a miracle happened. Overnight, the army went from this defeat attitude to one of, let's go get the Chinamen. Let's go north, fix bayonets.
And it was about this time that the Chinese said that Americans, we were afraid of coal steel, that we relied on our air and artillery to do a fighting for us. I took exception to that. My forefathers fought in the Civil War and used a bayonet with lethal effect. And I called my troops together and said, we're going to start using the bayonet. It's a stupid thing to go charging against enemy machine guns, you know. When you do that, a lot of times the enemy sees those bayonets coming, and you're screaming like mad and so forth. They're scared and they run. And in the first couple of attacks I made, that's exactly what happened.
2 months later, UN forces had once again liberated Seoul. But fierce fighting continued around the 38th parallel, right where the war had begun. The plan to reunite Korea was abandoned.
I think it was in April of 1951, and then the Chinese hit us, and they hit us for about a month straight, and they really had their stuff together. The Chinese hit my platoon first, and all I could see was, in the beginning, was a forest moving towards me. In the forest was Chinamen holding little trees. We started cutting them down and bringing in artillery. We were able to drive off the enemy, but not until that there were stacks of enemy in front of my platoon, 3 to 4 feet high.
When we were stopped at what is approximately the 38th parallel, the demilitarized zone now, we weren't stopped because the Chinese stopped us. We were stopped because the politicians stopped us.
As the bloodshed continued, President Truman began to seek a diplomatic way to stop the fighting.
I believe that we must try to limit the war to Korea for these vital reasons: to make sure that the precious lives of our fighting men are not wasted, to see that the security of our country and the free world is not needlessly jeopardized, and to prevent a third world war.
But General MacArthur disagreed with the president, defiantly insisting that there was no substitute for victory.
MacArthur made it known that he wanted to go to all-out war against China. To have expanded the Korean War as MacArthur wanted by even using the atomic bomb against China would have been a mistake of biblical proportions.
The tense situation exploded in April of 1951. MacArthur publicly criticized U.S. policy in Korea and was relieved of his command.
I now close my military career and just fade away.
The war raged on for two more bloody years. Every day, the casualties increased. In Korea, the chance of getting killed or wounded was 1 in 9. But at the new Mobile Army Surgical Hospitals, or MASH units, the survival rate was high.
On a particularly bad day, the helicopters would come zooming in one after the other. They would have one patient on each side. Trucks would bring in the other wounded, and they would be 300, 400, 500 men. And we could operate, and we did, 24 to 36 hours at a stretch.
It was just one huge trauma room there. We had to do something. Laughter was the best policy for us. I mean, you had to have something funny. We had a group of doctors that called themselves the Red Lancers. And they all wore pith helmets, and they were like they were in the jungle or something. They used to pull tricks, funny things like take the nurse's underwear off the line and fly it on a pole or something. They really were like kids, but they were good surgeons. They were all in one tent. Now, if you saw the movie MASH, it was something like that. It was a swamp. They had these bottles hanging up with the martinis, and they had this sign with an elephant, and it says Semper Shikorum, which was Yiddish for always drunk. That's what they told us. I don't know if that's the truth.
When I first came to Korea, the doctors and nurses said, Chris, don't get involved emotionally with the patients because this is going to tear you apart and you won't be able to do anything. And I couldn't do that. The guys would talk about how proud they were that their fathers came to see them play varsity football when they were seniors, or how their mothers would bake a particular cake or make a party for them, what it was like having sex for the first time, and the sorrow that they couldn't have sex anymore because they were going to die.
Just prior to being inducted into the service, I was playing professional baseball with the St. Louis Cardinal chain. I was not a great player, and I didn't play that much, but the potential was there. But the war came along, and I was drafted. We had a break in the communications, as I recall, between our division and the Turkish battalion. And we went up to maintain those lines and to fix the break. And somewhere along the line, I tripped a landmine. Flew through the air, and then when I hit the ground, I looked and saw my right leg laying out in the field in front of me, and I lifted my right hand to do something. And as I did, I saw my little finger on my right hand hanging down about 6 to 8 inches with probably a tendon or something holding it on. They immediately dispatched a helicopter, and all I asked was, am I going to live? and nobody answered me.
3 days before Christmas, Andy was brought to the ward. Both of his legs had been blown off. Part of his hand had been blown off. He was the worst wounded man that survived that I dealt with in the war. He was so badly hurt that the doctors and the nurses said, well, he's going to die. And at that point, I said, no, he's not going to die. He is not going to die. Well, Christmas Eve, some of the doctors, nurses, and corpsmen went through the different wards singing Christmas carols. And they came into the ward, and they started singing Silent Night. And as they sang Silent Night, Andy opened his eyes.
I came to, and the doctor was there, and the doctor said to me, you're going to live now. And to this day, I still hum Silent Night when I'm in the shower. I lost both of my legs, most of my left hip and buttocks. My arm is wounded from the elbow up to the shoulder, and my finger is gone, and my index finger is very badly disfigured. Other than that, I'm in great health. At the time, I had thoughts about my career in baseball, but I just wondered if I had been physically well, whether I would have made it to the major leagues, but it's something that que sera.
With the war in a hopeless stalemate, peace talks began late in 1951. Throughout the protracted negotiations, United Nations and Communist forces faced each other from dugout bunkers, much like the trenches of World War I.
Once it got settled down, the lines were established, no one wanted to upset that and really go out and win the war.
Well, it's frustrating being a leader and knowing that in every one of your soldiers' heads, they're always playing this message, I don't want to be the last son of a bitch to go down in this war. So it took a special breed of soldier to go out and go on patrol. Here these guys could tomorrow cut a deal, and you were killed the night before.
The soldiers didn't know exactly what they were fighting for. They were telling us that we were here to stop communism. We get up in the morning, we jump on a tank or an armored vehicle and go all the way up there first until you encounter the enemy. And then you would shoot. You just have a little war going on. And at the end of the day, you get back on a tank and come on back. And then the next day, you do the same thing. The thing that that bothered me a lot of times in Korea was when I saw little orphans, little children crying. We went into this house. And we, you know, we're looking for people, you know, we're gonna shoot and everything. I kicked this door in, and I'm ready to shoot who's ever in there. And there's this old man laying in bed, just gray, he's dead. But there's a little young kid crying right there. Maybe I'm 4 or 5 years old. I still remember him.
They would fly over our position, and knowing that we were African-American troops, and they would say to us, why do you want to fight us? What have we done to you? When you go back home, you can't go in a restaurant. You can't get in the front of the bus. You got to get in the back of the bus. We're going to drop the pamphlets. And you pick the pamphlets up, and you cross the line, and we will treat you differently.
You know, after a while, you got to thinking, why is all this? And nothing was happening. It was just back and forth, back and forth.
More and more, the war turned into a series of battles for barren hills where lives were exchanged for real estate.
We had a terrible fight on a hill called 400, and I had 8 men killed. And they were my brothers, and so it was a terribly emotional experience for me. I can remember hugging one guy that was dead, and it
It got to me. You know, I remember the doc, Jimmy Mayamura, they couldn't get a vein. He was badly hit.
And so people gradually, after the casualties started mounting, people gradually came to turn pretty much against our involvement in the war out there. Maybe it's the first time we had had that kind of thing. That came much more to the fore later on in Vietnam, of course.
Many a mother was saying, why, oh, why is my son over there dying in a faraway land for a people we've never seen and a country we've never heard of? But of course, freedom is not free, so the war had to be fought.
There was a friend of mine who went to the Korean War, and he was playing bass with me at the time. And I've only written one protest song, and that was it. And it was about him having to go to war. This is the battleground. Where Jimmy learned to kill. Now Jimmy has a trade. And Jimmy knows it well, too well.
Fighting and the peace talks dragged on. There were major disagreements among the parties over how to exchange their prisoners of war.
The communists wanted all of their prisoners of war, over 100,000, returned to them. But the American policy was, no, we are not going to have forced repatriation. If the communist does not want to go back to the communist land, we're not going to force him to do so. And it is to our humanitarian credit that we did not force them to go back. But the price we paid was heavy.
UN and American POWs were forced to remain in the horrifying conditions of prison camps in Northern Korea and Manchuria.
They were probably mistreated more than some of us were in Vietnam even. And they put them in holes. They covered them up with mud up to their necks. They kept them in small rooms. It was thought control is what it was.
In our camp, in Camp 5, the rate of dying was horrendous. We had to get our boots cut off because we didn't, because the blood and everything we had in our shoes was frozen. I got caught stealing winter sneakers, and I was put in a bank safe, a concrete safe, until I confessed the errors of my ways in stealing from the Chinese people volunteers.
In 1953, some changes took place. Eisenhower had been elected as president, and of course, about that time, too, Joseph Stalin died, and shortly thereafter, the communists telegraphed that they were willing to sit down and finally reach some sort of a ceasefire, which was finally signed at Panmunjom on July the 27th, 1953.
They made the announcement that the truce had been signed and that we would be going home. Needless to say, everybody was just ecstatic. It was just one of the greatest exhilarating feelings in the world. You know, you're coming home. You're finally coming home.
One of the bright spots in the grim business is the road back to self-respect, dignity, and the feeling of once again belonging to the race of free men after months of a nightmarish existence.
I dreamed of all the whole time I was in the prisoner war camp of vanilla milkshakes. And I said, I want the biggest vanilla milkshake. You can put it over here in a wash tub if you got one. I got sick as a dog, but it was worth the wait.
Not all the soldiers came home from Korea. Today, almost 8,000 Americans are still listed as missing in action.
The first picture on this photo, and this is how I told the North Koreans, it shows us at a young age, about 1 year old, my brother and I slept in the same crib. This photo is the picture of Richard and I at Fort Lewis, Washington, where we were sent to join the 2nd Infantry Division before we shipped out for Korea. Now this photo shows my twin brother as a prisoner of war at Camp Number 5, we now know. Prior to this photo, we thought Richard may be dead. He was missing in action. 1953, I was reading the paper where the truce had been signed and prisoners of war were coming home. We looked at the list, looking for my brother's name. His name wasn't listed. In 1999, I put my message on the internet looking for my brother, anybody that knew my brother, and I got a call from Ron Lovejoy from Nevada. And he told me that he knew my brother and they became friends. He says, well, that young man, Richard, died beside me in prison camp. Well, 48 years of searching finally paid off. I guess about the only thing I have now is to get his remains home.
Only in recent years have the North Koreans begun to return the remains of U.S. and U.N. soldiers. They are still pawns in the continuing peace negotiations.
Well, I got his picture beside my bed. I look at it every night and say a prayer. And he's with me all the time.
We have a favorite story that Korean veterans tell. A guy goes to Korea, pulls his year there, comes home, and goes back to his job, and everybody says, where you been? You been sick? Our people considered a war that we didn't win. They saw no, quote, victory. And that's simply not true. We didn't go to Korea to win a war. We went to Korea to stop armed aggression. We succeeded in that.
Public support for the Korean War was never as strong as it was for World War II. Soldiers and sailors came home and rejoined their families, but they were not fully recognized for their efforts.
The people didn't look at us as doing a job in protecting democracy. They looked at us as if we did something wrong.
I'll tell you how it was different. When I came back, I went to visit people I'd known all my life, a girl that I'd grown up with from kindergarten on. I got there 8 minutes of 9 in the evening. And they said, oh, we're so glad you're home, Chris, and all of this. And then I wanted to tell them what it was like to have been in Korea. And they said, wait a minute, we'll talk afterwards. I Love Lucy is coming on now at 9 o'clock. I couldn't believe it. I was so flabbergasted, so angry, that I walked out of the house, and it took me like 2 years to be able to talk to those people again.
I wake up night sometime, with a cold chill and shaking. They call it PTSD, I guess. And I think I'm over there. And I see people getting killed. It happens maybe once or twice a month. But then I turn and see my wife there laying in bed. I'm able to go back to sleep.
I do have nightmares. It's just basically the same ones all the time. Getting captured, being in my cement vault, not coming home, or never coming home. Like we know there's a lot that never came home.
I remember my comrades, my buddies, my friends.
I remember them very painfully and tearfully, especially those that we lost. Those that paid a supreme sacrifice. And then I see people here that don't even understand, that don't even appreciate the value of their sacrifice.
Had we not gone into the Korean War, had we not stopped the communists, then South Korea would have been in its 50th year of communist domination. So I think that what we did there was the right thing.
To me, it was tragic that we didn't go ahead and win the war. If we had made an all-out effort from the beginning, we could have defeated the Chinese and reestablished the Korean nation.
It's sad that so many young men had to give up their lives, and it was never resolved. That's it. I think that's what hurts me most. It was never resolved.
An uneasy truce still exists today near the 38th parallel in Korea. The war that was never declared has also never ended. More than 1,500 American soldiers with the security forces have died there since the ceasefire in 1953.
Here we are 50 years later still trying to work that out, and we still have troops out there, which I favor. I think our troops are a very stabilizing factor there in the edge of the Kaesong Valley.
I think the main result of the Korean War on American sentiment was the realization that our involvement in foreign conflicts would not always enable us to bring about the results that we sought.
I think the Korean War, while it may have been a forgotten war as far as Americans are concerned, was never, never, never forgotten by the forces on the other side, the Soviet Union and her allies, the People's Republic of China. These countries knew that America would stand up and fight when she thought it was important.
The Koreans, they will never forget what the United States did for them. Their freedom today owes to the United States.
Now we see North and South Korea talking about cooperation for the first time. We see Korean families reunited that have been separated for 50 years. These are hopeful signs.
I went back to Korea. And there I saw what had happened, what the Korean people had done. In fact, I had to go to the train station to get my bearings on Seoul so I knew where I was at there, because we blew down every other thing there and they were all rebuilt. And Seoul to me looks like another American city.
A couple years ago, I went back to Korea. I was sitting next to a fellow that had spent 3 years in the prison camp. We were driving through Seoul and he looked out the window and he saw some kids going to school and playing in a playground. And he turned to me and he said, "Dick, look at those kids. This is the first time that I can understand and it makes those 3 years worthwhile."
The Korean War Veterans Memorial opened here in Washington, D.C. in 1995. It's a haunting tribute to the men and women who served there. In the early morning light, the 7-foot-tall statues almost seem alive. In their expressions, we see a powerful mixture of bravery, fear, and commitment. And we are moved to remember that freedom is not free.
And it's not a forgotten war, it is a forgotten victory.
This is Jimmy's grave. Where Jimmy's body lies. when a soldier falls. Jimmy's body dies and dies.
Major funding for this program was provided by the Disabled American Veterans National Service Foundation, working to build better lives for America's disabled veterans and their families. And by Ford Motor Company, proud to salute America's Korean War veterans. Additional funding provided by Bowater Incorporated, forever grateful for our veterans. By the PNC Financial Services Group, in thanks to those who serve our country. And by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.